We'll do it live.
Okay.
Well, no. We'll do it live! Fuck it!
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Eddie's Wall. It's been a really exciting week here at the Transworld Snowboarding Studios in Carlsbad, California. We've had the Insight movie world premiere that just went down, so we have a bunch of the guys in the office who were in the movie, and we're getting them all on the show. The best part about the show being live is the fact that you can comment in your questions and we'll get them answered. So this isn't just my interview, this is your interview as well, which is awesome because you guys usually have, you know, way better questions than I do. Right now, I'm really, really stoked and honored for our next guest because he really is a snowboarding icon. You might say he's like the pro snowboarder's favorite snowboarder. He turned pro over 20 years ago, which that in itself, like, I don't care if you have X Games medals or if you did the first triple cork or anything like that. It's to have a professional career that's lasted 20 years is probably the biggest accomplishment you could ever have as a pro athlete in any sport, especially snowboarding. So, yeah, I mean, this, he's got the best style, super positive. Everybody is just always looked up to him. So please put your hands together for Mr. Josh Dirksen. Oh, my phone just turned off. Wait, and there we go. Give it up. Make some noise. What's
up, Josh? Thank you, Eddie. Thanks for the kind words.
Oh, of course, of course.
Hello, everybody on Facebook.
Yes, hello. Live studio audience, killing it. You guys are the best. Oh, we're already getting some questions. Wow, you guys are firing them. You're not a short guy, so why is the Dirksen Derby shorter than the board I owned when I was 8? Wouldn't a bigger board be faster? Oh, wait.
So I can answer.
Yeah?
Some of that.
Yeah.
Here's his question. Solomon made a derby board.
Oh, okay.
And it just kind of fell into place, and it's called the derby board, and it's shorter and wider than kind of normal boards.
Yeah, because those, if you've seen the Dirksen course, it's very, like, really tight turns. So if you were on like a 165, it would actually probably be a lot harder to make it through that course.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a little different than
and
say
the Derby, like, for those you don't know, is a contest I've done for the last 9 years, and it's at Mount Bachelor and raise money for Tyler Eklund, our buddy who got really injured 9.5 years ago.
Yep.
And we get him up there and we run him down the course. And so kind of the start of the idea is to get him down the course, you know, get him like hanging out with people, having fun. And so that kind of like makes the layout slower and tighter and more friendly for everybody, and Tyler included.
Yeah.
And so that's the reason why I get some short boards in there.
Cool.
And it's just a fun opportunity to have just a board that turns like a skateboard.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the 47 turns as fast as my skateboard.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And it's almost like a like surfing like on a fish. It's like a short but fatter board.
Yeah. Yeah, and just kind of provides a different feel and fits into the style of riding. You know, you're not going to ride that thing in Alaska, but that's why you pull out a 72 when you go to Alaska.
Yeah, absolutely. dude, you guys are already firing off questions. This is awesome. I'll do. What year? What was the year that you started snowboarding?
1988. I think it was Christmas Day.
No way.
And, I was 13 years old, I believe, or that's the story I tell.
Yep.
Over the years, and went past Bunny Hill on a board that was a 150, but at that time it was way bigger than me.
Right, right.
And way heavier too, I think.
Yeah.
And went up with my buddy Justin Stafford, and kind of the first 10 years of my snowboarding life was kind of centered around like me and my buddy going to the hill and hanging out and riding Willamette Pass.
And then
Oregon.
Earlier you were saying that you turned pro around 96?
Yeah, I think so. I graduated from high school in 94 and then moved to Bend with Jason McAllister, my good buddy who became kind of a longtime pro.
Yep.
And we quickly got a job up at High Cascade in the summertime, and that kind of got the whole ball rolling. I met Todd Richards and all the Morrow guys, and Morrow was at that time a company out of Salem, Oregon. So from my house, it was only 2 hours away.
Right.
And so that was appealing part. And they made the boards there, and the boards were awesome. And all the people that worked there were awesome. You know, it's kind of a family feel. And so kind of that point, and I don't know when I exactly came pro. I think about 96 was the first time I had a contract that I signed.
Right,
Quit my job at IHOP. That was my last real job.
No way, IHOP, that's amazing. That's rad. What were you doing, the busboy?
I was a busboy / dishwasher.
Nice.
And I enjoyed it. It was a good job.
Yeah.
Kind of just doing your own thing, going at your own pace. But I definitely enjoy snowboarding more.
Yeah, snowboarding is a pretty good job. Tyler Romer, are you nervous, Dirksen?
yes, I am Tyler. And Tyler Raymer. He likes to be called Raymer.
Raymer, yeah. Sorry, Raymer.
That's an Austrian last name, I believe, but he's from Bend, Oregon, and he's a photographer I worked with all year long for the last like couple years, and he's from Bend, and he likes snow camping, and he's good at traveling through the woods and the snow and stuff.
Nice.
And so, am I nervous? Yes. I've kind of said that a few times, especially when the kind of everything got set up and they're like quiet on the set.
Yeah. But, it is funny because when people come in, they're just like, oh, aren't we just like filming this on their phone and stuff? And then when they come in, they're like, oh, yeah, it's kind of
this looks official.
Yeah. And they're like, 1 minute, 30 seconds. Like, let's see. So Tyler shot the photo that's the cover of Insight.
Kind of
the thumbnail that they've been using on the web page and everything.
Yeah, this little, exactly, the kind of Insight poster and stuff. It's this hole in the wall that we found down like southern Oregon and was on top of a ridge, and it was just this natural sun shining through from one side and then kind of dropped in like a little Jeremy Jones, Scott Stevens kind of shoot thing, and then you tucked through this hole and then it went into a perfect little quarter pipe. It was like hand plantable.
Yes. I remember that shot.
It was incredibly awesome. Like a little freak of nature kind of thing. Whoa, you know, the kind of thing you can't believe exists.
Yeah.
And Tyler shot that, and Tyler shot probably 90% of the other photos that I got this year. It's kind of me and him were the ones that were always motivated to go and and head up. So hello, Tyler.
Evan Francis Litsois, awesome, always commenting in. Thank you, appreciate that. Do you have any advice for guys who want to make the perfect turn? And that is a good question, because Josh Dirksen is, a lot of people, you know, say Dirksen has one of the best turns in snowboarding, which is probably a pretty underestimated skill or, you know, trademark. Because
or something that's more appreciated every year that goes by, I think.
Yeah.
You know, snowboarding is such a wide, like, variety of everything, you know. It's something that's easy to go, all right, that's the simplest version of snowboarding, and something to appreciate. And it's good timing with myself and my riding, because that's all I want to do these days, really.
Yeah.
If you watch my video part of the movie, I think I have frontside three and a couple grabs, and the rest is just turning.
Turning, yeah.
But it is what I love to do.
Yeah. I feel like it's almost coming full circle, because I feel like, you know, Craig Kelly and Tom Burt and those guys were all about doing these nice turns and figuring out how to do a really good turn and everything. And then it kind of started to go into the direction of just crazy freestyle and absolute nuts and jibbing and handrails and all of that. But then it's now, obviously, there still is all the crazy stuff, but it's almost like there's this new found respect and, you know, spotlight on turning.
Yeah. And back when I first started snowboarding, kind of, like, first 10 years, it was kind of, snowboarding was like racing, half pipe, jumping, you know, it was kind of, everything was a part of it, and turning was a big thing for sure. And, you know, that was Craig Kelly's influence and all those guys, but everybody did everything. And then kind of snowboarding started to become more exclusive, and, you know, I kind of went from going, doing everything, and then I kind of started being a pipe rider.
Yep.
And then I'd say I became more of a jumper, and then a little brief moment of extreme with Jones.
Yep.
And then now just turning, you know, and simple turning and having fun and like really getting to the top of my run and knowing that I'm going to enjoy it. No fears, no worries, and just dropping in, and turning is the simplest way to accomplish that.
Amazing.
But did we answer the question?
Yeah. That was, yeah, I mean, he was, yeah, okay. Oh no. Well, his advice for,
oh, what kind of boards?
No, just like any advice for
turning,
like, for just turning, or,
I mean, forward lean's a classic advice, and getting a board with a good clean side cut.
Yep.
You know, some of those magnet traction type boards are super awesome in certain situations, like holding an edge on steep stuff, but having a nice clean side cut's what I really appreciate.
Right.
And having a wider board, that's kind of where I've generally gone the last couple of years, just so you can, I think my boards are about 26.5 wide on average, and that kind of started with the Derby, Solomon's Derby 51 board that I got, and it's really wide, and I didn't have any heel drag, and I was like, oh, what's, you know, that's kind of my...
But is it a bit harder to go from edge to edge?
Not really. No. People, that was kind of the thing that people said in 1990, you know, but now it's like, I'm in no hurry, you know, I got plenty of time to get from the toe side to the heel side.
I love that. I'm in no hurry.
So it's like, you just get a nice cleaner edge with a wider board, and I think if you kind of look at most board lines, there's kind of wider is generally, you know, just something, give people options to fit the size of their feet and stuff.
Right. Evan Litsois, have you seen the culture surrounding bank slaloms change over the years as you've continued the Derby?
I've seen the popularity increase, it's become more of a family reunion. I think that's what really people go there, and it's something that provides the opportunity where everybody can ride down the same course and, you know, compete against each other. And that's something I try really hard to make the Derby possible, like having everybody from Tyler Eklund and Isitsky to, you know, the top guys like Blavelt. And,
yeah, Pat Moore's there.
Kind of like so many people. It's crazy how many people come.
Yeah, it is. It's
But it's a family reunion, really. You know, everybody comes there because they know they're going to see their buddies. And at the start of the season where you can be like, what are you doing this year?
Yeah,
and like everybody's plans have fallen into place. And
Well, actually, and while we're on the topic, so you've done it for the past 9 years. But then this season you decided to... Or this past season you didn't have one?
I'd say it was about 3 days after last year's Derby that I decided. But I didn't really say anything. But last year's Derby was spectacular, like 4 feet of pow and 567 racers and 40 grand raised for Tyler.
Wow.
And it was incredibly awesome, but it wore us out, you know. And it really just kind of set the schedule of my year and our year. I'm married to a Swiss girl, so we live in Switzerland on Zurich Lake half the time.
Yep.
And so it kind of gave us, by delaying the Derby, we got a Derby gap year. So the Dirksen Derby 10 is officially December 15th, 16th, 17th, 2017.
Okay.
So note that 2017 on the end. It's not coming up this year.
Don't show up this and this is
you can show up, but there won't be a Derby course, and I'll be in Switzerland. But we're just going back to spend the holidays with you know, the Swiss side of the family. And,
cool.
And
so you spend your summers there?
Yes, summers and falls. For the last 9.5 years, it was summers and falls in Switzerland. And then I come back for the Derby and then kind of spend the winter traveling to wherever is good. But this will be the first year postponing the Derby. The official title is the Derby gap year, is this year. And so by doing that, it just gave us time to switch up our schedule. So we've been in Bend, Oregon the last couple months and surfing their new river wave that we got in town.
I heard about that.
Yeah, it's incredibly awesome. Bend is like, it's a whole different town in the winter too, or winter than summer. Summer, there's 30,000 more people in town.
Whoa.
On average per day.
Wow.
And and so it was fun seeing it green, and it'll be fun going back to Switzerland for the snow and kind of get that early season.
Yeah.
And Alex Yoder has a new motor home and some plans that he's gonna do, so I'm gonna hop in the bus with him.
Sick.
But as far as the Derby, back to the Derby 10, like for me, it's all the same. I just have more time to plan for it.
Yep.
You know, we've been planning, and the Film Fest will be a big part of it. We're gonna start out the Derby with the Film Fest on Friday, which is a filmer, photographer, and Sitski video park competition.
Okay.
And then we go on to the snowboard race up at the hill and on Saturday and Sunday. And just for me, it's just more time to get excited and like plan out stuff and like kind of talk to people and say like, I'll get back to you in a couple months, instead of like, it's here now, we gotta decide.
Right.
And
right.
So for me, it's more fun. And for everybody else, I think you guys can handle it.
Yeah.
And it doesn't necessarily mean we're not gonna be an every year event.
Right.
Like I've actually also started planning the Dirksen Derby 11 for 2018.
Yeah.
And so it's a year later. And cool. We're just kind of setting things in place and thinking of cool ideas. And my dad's, who does the trophies, and there's like 58 trophies in the Derby now.
Whoa.
With so many divisions. And
wow.
And so he went on a 2 month vacation, so it kind of works out good for him. He doesn't have to make those. And Adam Haynes, the artist, had a baby the other day.
Is
congratulations,
that the artist?
Adam.
Yeah, congrats, Adam. Is that the artist who does the...
Yeah, it does every poster
those
for the last like
really,
6 years. Yeah.
Really cool.
Yeah, he does so much cool stuff.
Like,
he does all Temple Cummins graphics and Barrett Christie's and like so many. And he started out, kind of what made him famous was the Nike 6.0 ads, like really perspective
ones,
driven.
And he did one just for like, I think it was like for the Supernatural or something, and it's like looking up, and it's all.
I got that thing framed, like custom wood frame in my house. It's like this
really
big. It's awesome, with no logos on it too.
Whoa.
Just the pure artwork.
Oh man, that's insane.
Yeah, he's an incredible artist, and by far my favorite.
Really
and
cool.
Pretty much a neighbor.
Okay.
And so kind of, you know, we just walk over there and do cool stuff.
That's cool. Yeah, I was actually gonna ask you about that, because the last one you guys did, It's like the whole course, but then it almost looks like a Christmas tree, I feel like. Or like, like a pine tree.
Yeah, that was the eighth annual. That one was, we're really proud of that one. And then the kind of Derby tuck, that was a really cool one too.
Yeah.
Those were, I think, mine and Adam's two favorites.
Awesome.
But the eighth one kind of came in, like there's a hidden eight in the trees and stuff.
Oh,
and
cool.
Kind of just stuff, you're like, ooh, that's creative and cool.
Yeah.
And yeah, me and him work well together. It's fun working on projects.
Hell yeah. All right, let's bang out some of these questions. David Klein, 26.5 centimeters wide, ? What boot size do you wear?
I wear size 9.5
boots,
which isn't that big by any means. But then I have Salomon's Shadow Fit binding, which doesn't really have a heel cup.
Yeah.
And so kind of as far as heel drag and toe drag, my board, I'd say I have about that much. Maybe it's like pretty much nothing.
Nothing, right.
And it makes a difference. And it just makes that edge like just clean, you know. You don't kind of bump and have the question in your mind if you're gonna skip out a little more. You know, it's just kind of you can just rail turns and you kind of get the most out of that side cut. And so it's wide, but I'd say if you look at boards these days, there's a lot of like options for like a lot of people are riding bigger boards.
Garrett Joseph, how big should your foot be to ride a wider board?
Pretty much doesn't matter.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't need to be too wide. I think Extreme Jeremy Jones has like, he has a tiny little foot, like a 7.5 or 8.
Yeah.
You know, and so a lot of his boards, like a 25 centimeter wide board fits perfect. You know, he doesn't have any drag either.
Right.
But for myself, I just kind of got to the point where I didn't want toe drag and I got the board that didn't have it.
Yeah.
And it all kind of started with that Derby 51 board from Salomon.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, what's the point of having heel drag?
Yeah.
That's kind of my big complaint right now is like, I don't want heel drag. That's like my ultimate goal in snowboarding is to get rid of it. And I think I've done a pretty good job.
Sean Harry, Robot Food videos capture the fun in snowboarding, so I was wondering if they were also fun to film and shoot.
Yeah, honestly, like we joked about that, which was fun, but we joked about how it was a different project in the end. You know, like going through, there's obviously, like we were all like driven snowboarders and filmers and photographers and everybody part of it, and it was a project and we worked hard, and of course there was stresses and stuff, but I can say, looking back on it now, and I think everybody who was part of it can say like, oh yeah, that was super awesome. You know, it's one of those things that's, you know, difficult when it's happening and stuff, but the final project and the final, you know, just looking back on it was super satisfying and like, oh, that was incredibly cool.
Yeah.
And so it was fun to look back on, but that's plenty of things in life.
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily, you know, it's hard work when you're doing them, but when over you time back, you're like, oh, that was awesome.
Yeah.
Did it.
And speaking of Robot Food, Pierre Wickberg, who was the main filmer for Robot Food and director, love the Dirksen Derby. When was the last time you did a 900? because that was in Robot Food, I think, right?
Robot Food after Lame, which is their third video. I didn't talk on a film for like 5 years after that because of these quotes, but now I can look back and think they're kind of funny. But one of my quotes was I said I wouldn't do 900s if I had the choice. You know, it's kind of for the sponsors. And there was a time when that wasn't true, but about that moment was for sure, like, even now, like, I barely grab my board, even.
Right.
You'll kind of see in the Insight movie part, like, you know, and I do, like, doing airs and ollies and stuff.
Yeah.
The last time I did 900, I bet it's been 8 years, 9 years. You know, for different reasons. I don't really have a desire. That's not a goal I have. And then just the boards that I ride, you know, not that, like, the Super 8 board from Salomon's, like, you can go backwards on it, but a lot of the boards, like, I picked a direction and it's goofy footed going forward, and, you know, so, like, a 900, I don't land backwards too much, or, you know, I kind of butter out of stuff or kind of flip it around, but my style of snowboarding is different than 10 years ago, and that's probably the last time I did a 900.
Amazing. Brian Hickson, what's your favorite park to shred?
My favorite snowboard park to shred?
Yeah.
I don't know. I've had some fun in some parks, for sure.
But do you steer clear of parks in general now, or not really? Or will you cruise through parks?
I pick up the powdery scraps that are there at the end of the day on the side of all the walls. and I have had some fun parks I've shredded. I mean, Super Park, I've gone there maybe 10 times over the years since they started 20 years ago. And I've definitely enjoyed riding the park, you know.
Yep.
And I can get into the riding park, but it kind of takes, like, you know, riding it and getting used to the jumps and getting used to that kind of style of riding.
Yeah.
And picking a board that's twin tip and and kind of more centered on my board instead of, like, 2 or 3 inches back and stuff like that.
It's funny because I was just thinking the other day, it's like when I go ride now, I don't go into the park too often. And I almost feel like it's because for so much of my snowboarding, it was so focused on riding the park and just like hitting these jumps and hitting the rails and just park and contests and everything.
Yeah.
And then it's like now that, of course, like, I mean, I'll cruise through a park but it's like I have so much fun like exploring the entire mountain and being like, oh, what's that little stump there? And and like finding all these little things or just going fast.
There's only so much time in the day, and riding a park's an investment. You know, you gotta figure out the flow and the speed and everything.
Right.
And, you know, I'm investing my time other places on the mountain.
Yeah. All right. Aaron Ziegler,
Ziegler. Sounds like a Swiss name.
Do you have any desire to check out White Pass in Washington?
Sounds right. I've ridden a lot of resorts with the name White in them that were awesome. Another question there is Whitewater. I see that name on there, and that's like one of the better resorts in the world, I'd say. It's up in middle of BC, interior BC.
Okay, Gentemble, Whitewater. Best week ever for me.
Yeah, that was a great week. That was incredibly awesome. But if anybody makes it up to Whitewater, that place is incredible. And White Pass, I'm not sure, but it sounds sounds good.
Yeah. And then Evan Litswa, have you learned anything special over the past couple of years worth of trips to Japan?
What's like, the question?
Have just I... kind of like learned anything by from taking trips to Japan?
Yeah, for sure. I guess, you know, with Japan, I've been there, I think I've traveled to Japan like 16 times over like my career.
Yeah.
And at the beginning, it was always kind of like premier tours and going to places that were golf courses in the summer and pipe contests and jump contests and stuff. And then it was kind of more recently as in the last 7 years, I started going to the North Island, Hokkaido, and Okuba, which is pretty near Tokyo, but it's like the Japanese Alps.
Right.
And so it's kind of recently that I found like incredible snow in Japan and really realized like how good it is. And so Japan for me now is like the best as it can be, you know, and the people that are there, just kind of the whole deal with it and the boards you see when you hop on a chairlift, everybody has an awesome, sweet looking board and, you know, kind of everything about it is really special.
Yeah.
And and it's been many times going there and really to really appreciate where I'm at now. It's like, wow, this place is awesome.
Yeah.
But incredibly cool. If anybody has a chance to go to Japan, I'd recommend it.
Kyle Sullivan, you're obviously chosen to live most of your life. You've obviously chosen to live most of your life in Oregon. What is it that makes you stay?
Makes me stay in Oregon. To be exact, I was born in Canada.
Okay.
To American parents and then lived there 2 years and then I moved to Oregon.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
All right. So are you Canadian?
Yeah, half Canadian. I got a Canadian passport. And
a U.S. one.
Yeah, American passport.
Cool. Okay. Yeah.
But I lived there for 2 years and then we came to Oregon and I lived there since.
Yep.
And then maybe I would have been tempted to like check out other places and go other places. But with traveling with pro snowboarding, you know, it's easy to go places and see what's out there and then come back home and appreciate how awesome it is.
Yeah.
And especially in Bend, Oregon, where I live or where I've lived the last, I don't know how many years, 20 years. It's really close to the mountain and Bachelor is really unique, which I've really appreciated over the years or come to appreciate just how special it is of a place in the world. And that's something I tried to highlight this year with the Transworld movie is just how awesome like my backyard is.
And now
just right out the door.
Bend, Oregon has surfing too, right?
Yep, little river wave. We got skate parks. And
so do they actually like build the river wave somehow?
Yeah, they had a dam that was 50 years old and falling apart and they had to raise money to replace that dam. And then the whitewater kayakers, I think we can be thankful for is they came in and said, let's make a whitewater kayak park. And then a little float through for the inner tubers that's like really incredibly popular in the summertime, people just floating through on inner tubes. And so it just kind of all fell into place and then opened up a couple months ago and it's this awesome little river wave and kind of sketchy.
Yeah.
You can crash pretty hard.
You can get
guys have scars on their head and broken fingers. And
I've heard of that.
After a little bit of time, you kind of learn what you're not supposed to do. And then if you avoid that, then it's a pretty fun, loving little wave.
That's cool. Yeah. Garrett Joseph. Are you hyped on all the carves coming back in the Yaguns videos?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are awesome.
Yeah.
For
those,
sure.
Those are pretty cool. Those guys are really awesome, I think.
Yeah.
Alexandru Tufienu, what's your favorite place to snowboard?
I mean, the classic answer is Bachelor.
Yeah.
For sure. And it's just a really special type of terrain with all the wind lips and, you know, it's really skate parky, which is something that's kind of Oregon in general is cement skate parks and really flowy lines. And so it's something I can relate to pretty quick. And then just growing up there, I can relate to it really good. And it's special. So, yeah, Bachelor's my answer.
All right. Alexandru, that's what we just said. Lucas Foster, I better see you at the LBS this winter.
Yeah.
You on?
I will for sure.
Yeah. LBS, Legendary Bank Slalom.
Yeah.
Baker.
February-ish. Okay. Solomon's making me up some boards with black bases on them. They love doing that.
Oh, that's pretty dope.
That's kind of Solomon style. Faster the better.
Yes.
And I got a 63 ordered for that race and a black base. And I think that one's even like 25 or 26.6 wide.
Whoa.
It's like even a little wider. Big old nose, sharp little tail. It's an awesome board. That's my board of choice this year.
That course, that Bank Slalom is essentially like the most polar opposite from the Dirksen Derby, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and
because of, I mean, just the course.
Yeah, to be honest, like the Derby was because of the Baker Bank Slalom. You know, I've been going there for years and years and years.
Yep.
And it's almost like I have, or don't have to go, but it would just feel weird if I didn't go. You know, it's just kind of a part of my season that's, and then, you know, as I get older too, I don't quite get more competitive by any means.
Right.
You know, it's kind of, but it's fun kind of putting myself in that position once a year when I'm at the start gate, like, my binding's tight enough, you know, and kind of freaking out. And so I try to think of that stressful moment as enjoyable and try to keep myself in the mix and see all the people that do go up there.
Yeah.
But it's a fun part about all of it, but it's fun how you can just tweak out and crank your forward lean up more than you want and tighten your bindings down until everything like strips out and like, ah. but it, one of those things that's not as fun when you're doing it, but looking back, super enjoyable.
Yeah. Yeah. Noah Lane, are you working with Patagonia to develop more snowboard-specific gear?
For sure. Yep. Yeah, they that's kind of what Patagonia does, and they brought us on so that we could make their products more snowboard-friendly, yep. You know, and kind of part of that was just making the pant legs a little bigger so they go over high backs and stuff, and then getting into splitboarding and kind of backcountry travel, you can really realize the benefits of having better quality clothes,
right.
You know, that breathe well and layers and stuff, and,
yep.
And so for sure, I want it and they want it too, yep. So it's a friendly relationship. We like do help each other out getting the best product for what I need to do in the backcountry.
Yeah, and actually maybe while we're on the subject of Patagonia, I feel like you should give a shout out to your sponsors right now, because I personally want to give a shout out to your sponsors because I really respect, you know, the sponsors who are, you know, continuing to sponsor guys who've been pro for a while. And because, you know, I feel like in skating and surfing, it happens a lot. They really take care of the guys who have been put in their time and set the benchmark and the path for all the younger generations, where I feel like in snowboarding, a lot of times what happens is the day you're not winning the contest or the day you're not doing the double cork, then they're like, hey, thank you so much. Peace out, you know?
Yeah.
And so shout out your sponsors, because you guys are awesome.
Yep, thanks to my sponsors, Patagonia and Solomon and Smith, Mount Bachelor and Crab Grab.
Bam.
That's kind of a new one, but Preston lives right down the street and it's super fun working with him. But I'm super lucky with my sponsors. Like, I honestly don't think they could really fire me too easy. And I wouldn't be no harm done if they did or they didn't have the budget for it. But kind of like they're really family. Like all my sponsors I've been with and just for so long and just done so much with them. And we've all had kids at the same time. You know, stuff like that that's I think for all my sponsors, if I keep snowboarding and having fun, that they don't care. Right. What I accomplish so much.
Right, right.
And luckily I do accomplish stuff and they can, you know, write it off as a benefit. But I think they're just kind of, all my sponsors are just stoked to see me kind of keep going.
Absolutely.
So thank you guys.
Yeah.
Patagonia, Solomon, Smith, Batchy.
Brandon Sauer, what's your favorite run at Mount Bachelor?
I don't know, I guess it doesn't have a name.
Right.
Like, I don't think I know too many of the names of runs at Bachelor.
Yeah, that's funny.
Just kind of,
I don't know the
names. Zigzag around and... You know, there's stuff called red line that's, you know, a general direction, but everything else is just kind of
cruising.
I don't know, maybe jump names. That'd be kind of like go to Zimmerman's and then go to Hidden Valley, you know, kind of lines. That's how you explain it. But yeah, not too many actual run names
that
I know of.
Cool. Joe Larg, love these shows, Eddie Wall. Keep them up. Thank you so much. Oh, I'm a fellow PA kid. Thank you, Joe Larg. Joe Larg. Boom, you're the man. Thank you. Christine Lee. I'm going to Niseko for the first time. I'm generally in the park. Do you have any advice for the deep powder?
Yeah, get a good board. You know, a board that's like a powder board, you know, that either has length or width to it and a big nose.
Yep.
And directional. You know, a little bit of taper will help out. And when you get there, you'll fit right in.
Yep.
And, you know, everybody has figured that out. And it's like Niseko's flat.
Right.
Like it's a volcano and just how volcanoes are, it's like 30 degrees. And so when you get so much snow, you obviously want some good float and, you know, bring... like the ability to wax maybe, or like a rub-on wax to keep you moving, stuff like that. It's cold, bring some clothes so you can stay out all day.
Bring clothes, that's
pick an awesome board and you'll be stoked.
Lucas Foster, have you or do you think you'll ever come ride in Telluride, Colorado?
I think I rode a Telluride. Was there an X Games there one time like 15-20 years ago?
Maybe
that's Crested Butte.
Maybe, yeah.
But maybe. I mean, I have had some amazing days in Colorado, and his Telluride's kind of more southern, isn't it? That's kind of, I went to Silverton for like years straight. That place was so awesome.
Yeah.
And that area.
I think last year was my first time ever going to Telluride.
Oh, yeah?
It was random. I was like going to be a stunt double for a snowboard commercial, and they were filming it in Telluride. So they like flew you out, and it's so funny because when you do like commercial stuff, it's like I had an entire condo to myself, and they're like, yeah, this is like normally what we get. And I was just like, oh, you guys are not in the snowboarding world, or I would have been at like the Motel 6 with 9 of the cameramen. They got me my own condo. It was just like, anyways, And man, I was blown away by how like nice that resort is, and how like the whole town.
Incredible
is,
terrain. I think Harry Kearney has a bunch of shots from there this year.
Oh yeah,
like really awesome shoots and stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
yeah. It's, so I would like to make it out. Not enough time in the season usually to make it everywhere, but it looks awesome. And if I do make it out, I'd like to hang with Harry Kearney there. He looks like he knows where he's going.
Yeah, for sure. And actually, they had just got done shooting that Quentin Tarantino movie.
The Hateful Eight?
Yeah, The Hateful Eight. And so the whole town, like when we rolled in, they're all like, oh, yesterday Quentin Tarantino was in here. Da-da, they all just left. And I was like, oh, well, that's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But okay, so Pietro Fedon, what you think about the future of snowboard? Question mark. K2 has been sold. Quicksilver has a lot of debt. And many pros in the Olympic Games didn't have a sponsor. Maybe back to the origins.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I don't stress out about it. There's like too much stuff in this world to stress out of that with the, you know, and snowboarding too. It's of course like more people are going to get involved. It's going to become more diverse, and that doesn't mean everybody has to pick that direction and go for it.
Yep.
You know, and so yeah, I'll just keep doing my thing, and I recommend that everybody else just do what they love in snowboarding and avoid the stuff they don't, and try not to talk too much bad stuff.
Yeah.
You know, it's like big happy world, and that's how it goes.
Yeah.
When we get more popular, more riders, and of course, everybody has their own direction and dream of what it should be.
Yeah.
It doesn't need to be everybody's dream.
Yeah.
So for me, I don't mind.
Cool.
Yeah. Just keep snowboarding interesting.
Hell yeah. All right, we got some more questions here. Victor, Paris, Alia, what are you planning on doing, or are you planning on doing a splitboard movie anytime soon? And cheers from Splitboard Magazine crew.
Oh, hello, right. Splitboard Magazine crew. Splitboard movie? I don't know. I guess my whole part for the Transworld movie was on a splitboard, pretty much. Like I'd say 95% of the shots in there.
Right.
And so I have a yellow jacket. All the yellow jacket shots in my movie, in the movie part, are backcountry. And then there's a couple random batchy shots that we threw in there just because that's my inspiration, I guess.
Right.
And fun to ride and fun to sneak lines out there.
Yeah.
But actual splitboard movie, I don't know. I guess probably not, but maybe it would just happen. You know, that wouldn't be my plan to do that, but to access a train that I want to access, then it most likely involves splitboarding, so maybe that would happen by default. But as far as a splitboard movie, probably.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about it, because your part actually was essentially a splitboard part.
Yeah, totally.
In Insight movie, the latest Transworld movie that just had the world premiere 2 nights ago.
Yeah.
I think you had a really good quote in one of the, we're doing like this series of Insight movie videos that have been dropping online. We did one on the Dirksen Derby. We have another one of you coming out soon, so make sure you guys tune in for those. But you had a funny quote. It said something like, "The wind lips are the real stars of my video part. I'm just kind of in there," or something. Explain what your mentality was going into this season.
Well, my mentality was how awesome it'd be to stay at home and, you know, get that terrain. And then after years of hanging with Jeremy Jones and stuff and the guys involved with the Jeremy Jones projects, you know, I've become pretty efficient at going places in the backcountry. And in Oregon, pretty much all our volcanoes are closed off to snowmobiles. And so you get to the boundary line and you can't take a sled past or heli or anything, of course. And so it involves splitboarding and kind of camping and stuff like that. And so my goal was just to find this terrain that's we find easily at Bachelor, but we have to find it quickly because it gets tracked quick.
Right.
But, you know, find that terrain and just kind of have the whole day to enjoy it and, you know, easy living. And it is really, really unique, that terrain, like how the wind lips. And when I say wind lips, I think everybody probably goes, oh, it's a big long wind lip and you slash, slash, slash.
Right.
But kind of what forms around Bachelor, kind of on all the trees and the hammered, like wind hammered tree lines, it like comes out with wind lips that have like hips and bends and slashes. And
yeah.
And it's really incredibly special. And of course, there's other places in the world where you could find it. We went to Chile a couple weeks ago, and we went to a place that's pretty far south and a huge volcano range, and we found some awesome terrain that was the kind of style of stuff that I look for these days. But Bachelor is like, or actually the Oregon Cascades, and kind of even to like Shasta in California and Rainier. And like they just get hammered by the ocean and the wind and everything, and it just forms this awesome sound.
I'm your biggest fan. I saw you were here.
Oh, jeez.
I just wanted to get an autograph.
Whoa.
All right, what we got here is Colin D. Watt.
Josh Dirksen.
Personality in snowboarding and a filmer. And from this moment on, he's a photographer too.
apparently.
Yeah. Oh, did you shoot this photo?
I did. Yeah.
That photo is insane. We posted that on the Instagram and it like killed it.
Yeah, it was pretty
legend.
Funny.
Legend.
So that's my daughter. 20,000 views.
Yeah.
Yes, I can't give you a quick little.
Two of my favorite snowboarders, Josh Dirksen and Alana Dirksen. Legends.
So that's my daughter. She's 3. And it actually worked out pretty good. I like locked her on my back with her hands over my shoulders, and then I kind of grabbed Melon on the board, and it was lockdown. Like, it was like, for toe side turning especially, there was like, I could turn as hard as I wanted, and then heel side I'd be a little more hesitant, but
yeah, heel side,
but kind of a lot of good days, like good old days last year, we kind of cruised around the hill, me, my wife, and my kid on my back. And she'd get a couple turns on the flats and stuff, but we did that quite a lot.
She can rip on her own. She's a Dirksen. Come on.
Yeah,
but she's only 3.
Here, let me get you in here, guys. Let me show you this.
Go live.
You see that? You gotta see it?
She's dangling on my back. Yeah, but it is interesting to think what her perspective on like a black run is gonna be in a couple years.
Yeah, right?
You know, when I've taken her down like as steep as it gets, kind of.
Yeah.
Dude, but yeah. So,
thank you. Yes. I'm now going to take this book and sell it on eBay. But you can buy it online.
All right, that's amazing. Never a dull moment.
Colin D. Watt. He filmed a bunch of stuff, and we went on just kind of in general a lot of camping trips last year, and really entertaining dude.
Yeah.
Really like cranked to 11 a lot of times.
He doesn't seem like it. He seems real mellow, and yeah.
But he does know how to like tune it down when the time comes.
Yeah.
You know, he was a good camping partner.
Yeah,
positive, so, and incredible snowboarder too.
I was going to talk about that too. Obviously, splitboarding takes a lot of time to get all the way out there and everything. Did you guys find yourself camping a lot, or were you able to do quite a few day trips?
We were able to do day trips, but kind of camping, kind of the best times, like as it goes into evening.
Yeah.
And morning, but when you go into evening, you just want to snowboard till dark, and then once dark hits, like, oh, I don't want to go home.
Right.
So it's nice just being able to set up camp, but you can be really quick and nimble when you don't have your tent and sleeping bag and stuff, and so it's kind of a, like, I don't know, like, it's kind of a choice.
Yeah.
It's fun camping, just life slows down, and
yeah.
And you know, so that's a super nice
benefit.
Would
you guys usually just do one overnight or two, or?
I'd say 1 to 2 was kind of normal.
Yeah.
See, it's super nice having a full day in the backcountry, and so kind of going out camping, spending a full day camping, and then heading back at the end of the day, that third day. You know, that's a nice pace to have.
Then, big question: Do you sleep with your snowboard boots on, or do you take them off?
I take them off.
You do.
You take the shells off, and then you sleep with your boots kind of right here is a kind of a comfortable spot.
Yeah.
With your liners, sorry. So you leave the boots out, and then you bring in your liners and you bring in your gloves and stuff dries.
Yeah.
Like in a sleeping bag, you stuff it all in there and stuff stays warm and dries out and with just body heat and stuff. And so that's when we camped out for 27 days in Alaska. That's how you kept your boots dry.
And, 27 days? Oh, with Jeremy?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, not this year.
My gosh.
But,
was that
for 27 days.
Was that pretty gnarly?
That was intense was a word for it for sure.
No, you were literally intense.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was nice. I mean, setting the pace, it's nice when you don't have all those distractions of life and cell phones and computers and emails. You know, we're just out there. And we had sat phone for kind of emergency situations, but pretty much we were just kind of focused on just doing that job. And it was kind of going snowboarding was a sunny day plan. And then when it starts snowing, it was keeping your tent from being buried. And so every day was exciting, and it was awesome. Just the crew, and it was incredibly cool.
Wow.
I'm thankful that kind of came around in my snowboarding career at the time.
Yeah.
Hanging with Jones and TGR and all those filmers part of it. And back to like Colin and stuff, and the guys who film for all these projects with splitboarding, it's a tough job just how much weight you have to carry.
Yeah.
You know, they have to carry all their splitboard gear, camping gear, and like tripod and cameras. And,
right.
You know, it takes a motivated person to be good at that job.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So Noah Lane, if you could see any older legend put together a new snowboard video part, who would it be? Good question.
I'll be clever with my answer. I'd say Alistair Schultz.
Oh, dude.
He's a kind of the guy who was a step ahead of everybody else in Oregon as far as like pro snowboarding. And, you know, back in the day, he's like the guy that I looked up to, and like incredibly smooth style, which influenced like my desire to have like a smooth, clean style. And he's about the same age as me, maybe a year or two older.
Yeah.
And he still snowboards. He comes out for the Jerry Lopez Big Wave Challenge, a bachelor in the spring, and
cool.
And snowboards and surfs a lot. But for sure, I'd I'd love to see a part of him.
Cool.
Especially if it was slashing wind lips at Bachelor or like getting him into the backcountry stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Alistair Schultz.
Good style. Charlie Giacola? Giacola. Do you have a favorite day riding on icy conditions?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, icy doesn't quite sound right, but. But I claim these days that I'm not looking for pow, you know, and I claim that I'm looking for untracked snow.
Right.
You know, I've had plenty of like incredible turns on snow that's like only like that deep, you know, and it's something that's just easier to find if you're just looking for untracked snow. And
yeah.
And so like ice could be part of that, but I do like to hold an edge.
Yeah.
So maybe I'd need to sharpen up my edges before that icy day, but.
Brandon Sauer or Sauer. What is your opinion on energy drink sponsorships and snowboarding?
I don't know. I mean, I grew up, when I was 19, 20 years old, I drank a bunch of Coca-Cola candy, and people love to joke about it, especially like Todd Richards and stuff. And so, I mean, and these days, I prefer water over all that stuff. I can't remember last time I had an energy drink or anything.
Right.
But I don't know. I mean, if somebody's... Like back when I was 20 years old, I would have rode for Coca-Cola, no problem, just because I'd be like, more free Coca-Cola, for sure. But now times change and it doesn't really relate to me or, you know. And so for myself, I ride for Drink Water. I guess that's technically another one of my sponsors.
Yeah.
And I drink a lot of water and I enjoy it. And there's tasty water in Switzerland that comes out of all these wells and they're all different. You can kind of taste the difference.
Yeah.
But I'm all for it.
Cool.
Whatever. And especially if it makes it work and, you know, cool stuff happens with money, and it's fun seeing like money get involved. And like with Travis Rice projects, it's like almost over the top, like how amazing it is. But I'm dazzled, man. I like watching all those fancy projects and people doing things when they have the opportunities. And
cool. Noah Lane, can you talk about the importance of pack weight for overnight split trips? What luxuries can you not live without, and what are the main items you save weight on? Good question.
Yeah. So packing for an overnight trip. I kind of make a list at the beginning of the season with the things I bring, and then if you go on a camping trip and you come back and you didn't need it, then you can scratch it off the list. You know, it's nice having luxuries, and, you know, if I go out with four Shearys, bringing out solar panels and, like, all this cool stuff and speakers, and, you know, it's cool when that's there. But for myself, I try to keep it simple. I, you know, leave out stuff sacks. That's a good start. And get lightweight backpacks and... But just keep a list at the start of the season or for the rest of your life and, you know, just kind of dial in what you want.
That's kind of a good idea. Like when you get back, be like, okay, I didn't use this.
Yeah.
So I don't need to bring that next time.
And then the next time you pack, like I can pack to go overnight camping in like 10 minutes, maybe, you know, and know that I'm not forgetting anything because I just go through the list. I'm like, got it all.
Wow. Cool.
And, which is super nice too. Because you want to go out when it's good snow and good, you know, at the right time. And so being able to like run out the door when you're like, realize that time is now.
Yeah.
You know, so be able to pack quick.
Yeah. It was funny, not for winter camping, but just my wife and I went to Southeast Asia for 4 months a long time ago, just straight backpacking. And we, you know, started off with these massive backpacks. And within like 2 weeks, I just gave away everything in my backpack. I was like, okay, I need 2 shirts, you know, a couple pairs of
no
underwear.
No one to give it away to out in the backcountry.
Wants
this extra sweatshirt?
but yeah, I think you always need probably a lot less than you feel like you do.
Yeah, for sure. You don't need much by any means. You know, you'd, like when you're going overnight camp and you got a sleeping bag and a tent, then you don't really need like all the layers to stay warm. You know, we kind of snowboard till it gets dark, eat dinner, and then go to bed, and then try to wake up early.
Yeah.
You know, and so it's not like you're hanging around a campfire, like, stoked with, 10 layers of puffy jackets and pants and slippers and stuff like that.
Right.
You know, it's kind of, like, you can make it pretty simple if you want.
Yep. Bryce Ty, the Dirksen rock out at Blue Lake is all time.
Well, you know, it's funny, I think I do know which one that is, but somebody, maybe a couple months ago, they're like, yeah, there's a Dirksen rock, and I'm like, oh, yeah, and, I think I, what are they?
Oh, out in Blue Lakes in Tahoe?
Yeah.
There's a Dirksen rock.
Yeah, I guess so. But I just learned recently about it too.
Oh.
Yeah, I think I maybe cab 3'd on it one time, and it kind of lands into trees. You kind of shoot through some trees in the landing.
Oh, I wonder where that's at. That's cool. Yeah. And it's like a cliff or a dropper.
I think it's just a rock pile, kind of the size of the wall or something, that kind of sets up a perfect launcher into a landing. It kind of has it's really cool to film because you can kind of box it out with the trees.
Oh, cool.
It's kind of exciting to jump because you got to pick your direction and stick to it.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. But, the Dirksen rock. That's all. That's always fun. Mike Kansa. I could be wrong, but I think Dirksen back nine the pyramid gap back in 2000.
Yeah.
Way to shut down a spot before most dudes even got around to hitting it. I remember seeing that in the mag and was like, whoa, what the fuck? So gnarly. Anyhow, maybe it wasn't Dirksen. I can't even remember, but I'm sure pretty sure it was him. Groundbreaking. That was you, right?
Thank you, Mike. Yeah, that was me. And there's a few of us that hit it at the time, obviously.
Yeah.
And I think I hit that day, I hit it with Crawford, Andrew Crawford.
Yeah.
And but that was an incredible day. You know, when I look back on snowboarding, and specifically like pro snowboarding, if I pick like the top 5 days that were like, that kind of made my career last longer and kind of got me to the point I am now, that was one of those days.
Cool.
You know, just when things worked out and, you know, it was super awesome. And that's kind of that moment. Yeah, it was a really, really awesome day. And
that's pretty cool.
Yeah, pyramid gap.
Yeah. So, on that, you're saying, you know, there's like 5 or 6 big things. What do you think some of those are? Or in your mind, not necessarily, I mean, kind of career highlights, not per se your favorite day riding, but just like maybe some bigger moments in your snowboard career that you're proud of.
Yeah, that 9 on the Dirksen gap and those hip jumps that made the Transworld cover, and then there's a 1 foot or 2.
Yep.
And that thing was super awesome. And it's just kind of looking back, like I remember the days that just things went perfect. Like it didn't seem like I crashed at all. It's like, well, how did like that day happen? Like how it did, you know, just really special days. And, let me think. I don't know. Kind of a lot.
Yeah, I mean, that's,
you know, I keep thinking now, I'm like, oh, like filming with Jeremy Jones, but that's not really a moment. Maybe dropping a corrugated with Jeremy Jones. And that was a satisfying, like, it was kind of the end of that 27-day Alaska trip. And we skinned over the Canadian border and dropped into this line called Corrugated that Jones has been wanting to hit for years but couldn't because the helis were banned from going over there.
Whoa.
It was like a spine line, and Xavier and Rylan Bell and Jones and myself.
Whoa.
And, I wouldn't say that really influenced. The footage ended up getting frozen, I think, technically, it didn't come out. And that's something that's been nice with Digicam is coming out. Kind of when 16, like a lot of stuff happened. Like back in the day filming, like you didn't know if you had a shot until like it was at the premiere on the movie.
Like
things just happened and film was lost or cameras broke or the guy opens up the camera and it's just a big wad of nothing.
Yeah.
You know, and so kind of productivity-wise, corrugated wasn't anything special, but kind of in my brain, it was so awesome.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. Matt Baker, tell us about the trifecta this spring.
Trifecta. Hello, Matt Baker. That's my good buddy from Bend.
Okay.
And
is the trifecta race?
No, trifecta was me and Colin Watt, who just came in the door.
Oh, yeah.
He was out filming, and there was some good surf showed up on the coast, and the Oregon coast from my house in Bend is 4 hours. And so we went over and we surfed 4 hours surfed in the morning and then drove back. So the trifecta is doing all 3 sports in one day.
Yeah.
And so we surfed in the morning over there, drove back, and then skated at my house. I have a sweet ass mini ramp in my backyard, all skate light that my buddy Thane Mahler built.
Rad.
And then we went up to Bachelor in the evening, and that evening they were open till 7 o'clock. And so we shredded a couple hours in the evening and completed the trifecta. And it's something that a lot of people have kind of done, like Mount Hood to Wendell's, skating to the coast is kind of a popular one.
Yep.
But I was kind of embarrassed that I had never done it. You know, so many years of doing all those 3 sports and never in one day and being in Oregon.
Yeah.
And so we kind of made it the goal last year, like, to get it done.
That's cool. That's awesome. I think that is a pretty neat thing for anybody to say that they've done. It's pretty rad.
Yeah, it is super awesome.
Yeah.
And there's plenty of good chances to do it.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Eli Andrews, would you film for a Robot Food reunion edit?
For sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm down.
Pierre, where are you at? Michael Watts, Dirksen Derby, talk about the history and what spurred it into reality, and what are you thinking about for the future of it? We kind of touched on that in the beginning, but if you want to
talk about the Derby, talk about the history. It's 9.5 years now, and it's been super awesome. We raise so much money and so much stoke, you know, which are kind of the 2 things that I say I want to accomplish with that is raising money for Tyler. Because Jesse has a difficult life and he stays positive, and we want that money side of things to just be off the table and he doesn't need to think about it. But then raising stoke, like, he gets so excited, like, going up to the hill, and he's part of like this big awesome thing, and everybody comes out and everybody's so excited for the weekend and everything that happens. And so it's been a really cool part of my career and part of my life, being able to organize that and make so many people happy. And sorry if you guys are sad about the Derby gap year this year, but it'll be back just as good as it always was next year.
Yeah, yeah.
And and spurred it into reality. I guess it was just kind of entertaining the idea of doing a contest 9.5 years ago, and then going to Baker every season, you know, that was like, oh, Baker is awesome. And then, yeah, raising money, that kind of made our course shorter, tighter.
Yeah.
And so we could allow more people in so we can raise more money. Because cool. The money is directly how many people enter the contest, pretty much.
Right.
And so, should I continue on? Should we go on a new one?
Yeah. Saudi Vlad, how many days did you spend on your split board in the season?
This last season, maybe 40 days, I guess.
Yeah.
That was my main focus this season, and it was so accessible.
Yeah.
Like, just to go out my door and drive up to the hill. Kind of to get places, like, it takes some time, but kind of to get from where I was snowboarding home, it took, like, 2 hours, maybe.
Okay.
You know, it's pretty, like, quick to get back and quick to get out there. And,
yeah.
And, so a good handful of days, but I appreciate being able to ride a chairlift and make turns and stock up on vertical and, you know, and all that stuff. And it... With splitboarding, it's not really the splitboarding aspect of it. It's just I know where I want to go, and that's what takes me there.
Yeah.
You know, and like snowmobiles, I got nothing against them, but it's just they don't get me where I want to go anymore.
Right.
You know, and they don't get me, you know, they get too many people to go in there, too. And,
yeah, that's
you know, splitboarding, we don't see, out of those 40 days of season, we didn't really see anybody.
Yeah.
You know, maybe we'd see somebody like going for the summit on one of the mountains we're at, but pretty much you're just out there by yourself and you're like, this is awesome.
Yeah, you know? And you can't really beat that.
Yeah, it's super nice. So that's a good pace.
Well, yeah, I mean, I feel like we're kind of coming to the end here. Do you have anything else you want to bring up or mention before we head out? Or?
I don't know. Hello to my wife and kid, Robin and Alana. And Matt Baker, Pierre, all you guys, thanks for the questions. And all the people online, thanks for the questions.
Yeah,
glad you guys took part.
If you guys want to see Josh Dirksen's new video part, it is in the latest Transworld Movie Insight. We got the coffee table book here, which is pretty incredible. And you can pre-order this online, twsnow.com, as well as if you want to get some water bottles or t-shirts or whatever. But yeah, the Insight movie, it's going to be awesome. Also, stay tuned for some more behind the scenes with Josh Dirksen with the Insight movie videos that we're dropping. And yeah, thank you guys so much for tuning in and for your awesome questions. Josh, the only thing you have to do
sign the wall.
Sign the wall. There you go. Nice. Thank you very much.
Thanks to Transworld for supporting my plans and projects. And you know, I had an idea of what I wanted to do, and these guys made it happen, you know, made it all fall into place and made it sparkle. So thanks to all the guys at Transworld.
Absolutely.
Eddie for bringing me in.
Absolutely.
Pleasure.
Dude. Yeah, it's my honor. Yes.
And
give it up for Josh Dirksen, everybody. Oh, yeah. Anyway.